Andrew, just can we just give me some more water?
Good evening, folks.
Hi.
How are we all doing? I see some people are still connecting to their audio. You good there, Barbara?
Yes, fine. Thanks, David.
Good, good, good. I got Kamel coming in here. She emailed me saying how excited Di she was to hear from you, because she's actually in the process of creating some journals and manuals herself right now. So,
okay.
Yeah, sounds good.
Is that Barbara Everett?
No.
Oh. Hey,
no. but still excited.
Yeah. Di is someone I've known from afar and online in a virtual way for several years. And then we were able to actually meet up in London when she was in London with her son, which was so cool.
Yeah.
Really, really pleasant to so many virtual friends, Di, isn't it? You know what I mean? And then actually meeting someone in the flesh is just such a lovely opportunity.
And it's really interesting, because sometimes when that happens, you think, oh, what the heck did I see in them? But that wasn't the case with you, by the way, David.
I was a little bit concerned where that was going to go.
No, what I'm saying is that you just, in real life, you're exactly the same as you are online. You know, it was exactly the same, which is not often the case.
That's good to hear. That's good to hear. I think I would find it too difficult to be two people at one time. It's tiring enough just being one.
Exactly.
Hello.
Hello, Tiffany. Sorry to keep you waiting there. Di and I were just catching up. It's a while since we've spoken. So, yeah.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah. I was on, and we got a pet bunny, and I'm trying to chase him. But I wanted to make sure I wasn't late, so I just logged in early.
Hey, Charles. Hi, Nikki.
Good evening, everybody.
Hey, Louise. Hi, Sam. Hey, Bill.
Hello.
Hiya.
Good to have everyone in here.
Yeah.
Now, I've got to bring someone in just for one moment before we get started, because there's a very special young boy in my house who turned 8 today.
Oh.
Yeah, so I'm going to bring him in. And we've got to wish him a very happy birthday. Let me just go and get him. There you go. Say hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday
to you. Happy birthday, dear Joshua.
Joshua.
Happy birthday to you.
Joshua.
Happy birthday.
There we go.
Big.
Very special young man. Two very special young men here. Hey? Hey? Well done, Josh. See you later, buddy.
Bye.
There you go. I couldn't let that one pass, folks.
Oh.
No.
Bless his heart. Well, great to see you all here, folks. I am really, really proud and really delighted to bring Di Husser. Is that how you say your, how do you actually say your surname, Di?
Heuser.
Heuser. I would never have ever got that without you telling me. It's great to have Di Heuser here with us. Di, as I've mentioned, has been a longtime friend. We've been in the affiliate marketing space together for many years and in the kind of self-publishing space. Di, among other things, other than rearing chickens and growing vegetables, it specializes she's got a lot of strings in her bow, but she specializes in low content. And by that, I don't mean like just meager content, but low content books, which really talking about kind of manuals, journals, all of those kind of that side of publishing. But Di has really taken things a step further and kind of has become a seller of spades, if you like. That's you know, so, you know, there's the people who went to try and dig gold out of the mountains. Some of them struck gold and made mint. Others maybe didn't, but the people selling the spades and the buckets did very well, okay? Di is actually on both sides of that equation, creating her own products, creating her own books, selling her own books, not just low content, but certainly low content has been quite a focus for her. And also actually becoming someone who resources other people, who trains other people. Just before we came on the call tonight, Di was asking, you know, what's the purpose of these Monday night live calls? What are you looking to do? And as much as anything, folks, I'm looking to introduce you to the various opportunities that are available to you. Di is someone who takes hold of opportunity. When it comes knocking on her door, she takes hold of opportunity. There are a lot of people who tend to be ever learning, but never coming to a knowledge of the truth, ever learning and never actually applying what they learn. And what I've seen with Di over the years is she'll see an opportunity there and she'll really conceive, how can I turn this into a business that begins to generate income for me, an online business that generates income? And so, you know, while we've got Di with us here tonight, I'll be asking her some questions. She'll be sharing some things that are on her heart, but we also want to give you the opportunity to open mic, ask Di questions, whether that's about kind of entrepreneurism, building an online business, working with low content books, building and developing low content books, whether that's manuals, journals, diaries, whatever else it may be. Just before I hand over to Di, I'll just show you quickly let me share my screen here so you can see, because I do low content as well. And I can show you some of the things that I've been doing. So let me share my desktop here quickly. And then so you guys can see my screen, yeah? I tend to do prayer journals. You can see my prayer journals here on the screen. I'm taking it. Give me a nod if you can.
Yep.
Yeah, cool. Okay, so this is my prayer journals in the last 30 days. These are just some of them. These are the best-selling ones over the past 30 days. This is 60 days. Okay, so in the last 60 days, this is what I've earned from my prayer journals. That's the 90-day mark. I mean, obviously, people are buying them for stocking fillers at the moment. If I just go to all data, you can see I've earned 52,000 since I started doing prayer journals, probably a few years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, probably. Do you know what I mean? So I'm kind of last year I did 23,000. This year so far I've done 26. I mean, that will almost certainly top 30 by the time we get to the end of December. Obviously, there is some advertising costs that come off of this, etc. But this is the royalties that I've earned from my low content stuff. Like I say, I tend to, like most things, I do tend to focus very much on the Christian market, because that's just where I, you know, that's where I've set up my tent, if you know what I mean. But there are so many opportunities in this area, way beyond just like a prayer journal or a sermon journal and things like that. There are so many ways in which we can serve varied audiences. And oftentimes with the low content stuff, it can be supplementary to other things that you might be doing. You could write a book and create a manual. You could have a course and develop manuals that go along with that, or some kind of workbooks that go along with that. You could have a book and then create a kind of expanded version that has kind of low content pages in, like I've created books in the past, and then created an enhanced version that has kind of questions and answers and fill in the blanks and those kind of things. So there are all sorts of ways in which we can do this. And like I say, I brought Di in tonight to share her heart, open your eyes to some of the opportunities that are available, and just really talk into the entrepreneurial spirit that we've got here in the Christian Creative Academy. So Di, it is so awesome to have you with us. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? How did you get into this whole online marketing arena and move into, you know, I'm talking like in the low content area, but there are so many other things that you do that you may want to share about. Please just take the stage and introduce yourself to us, Di.
Okay, thank you. Well, it's really great to be here. As Dave has mentioned, we have known each other for a very long time. So by the way, just if you hear me lisping, it's because my jawbone is disintegrating. So I now have false teeth, which is very uncomfortable for me. So I just wanted to let you know that that's the situation. So that was one of the challenges this year, Dave.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
I started out, I became a single mom probably 20 years ago. And I had my own business, which then crashed and burned. I went insolvent, what you guys call bankrupt in the US, yeah. We call it insolvent in South Africa. And so I went from one job to another, and then I ended up at a company, which I thought was relatively stable, and then I fell pregnant. And a year after I'd had my baby boy, I was retrenched. And I think it was at that point that I'd suddenly realized I just had enough of working for other people. So I made the decision that I was going to go into my own business again, and this time go online. Because I think at that particular point now in South Africa, we were not as advanced as the UK and the US in terms of bandwidth and data and all that sort of thing. I mean, we were still running on 56K dial-up modems. And so I joined the Warrior Forum. I found the Warrior Forum through a rabbit hole, and that's where I actually met David. And I started learning about websites and online business and literally bootstrapped my entire way through the whole thing. And that was, I think it was 2010, David. It's 10 years ago. Long time.
Really? Wow. Have we known one another that long?
We have actually.
Oh man, I got
wrinkles.
Gray hairs.
Anyway, so, you know, the process of getting from that point to where I am now has literally taken, well, it took 8 years, because it was in 2018 that my business started to turn around. One of the things that I was doing was digital scrapbook designing in Photoshop. So I would design scrapbook papers and scrapbook elements, and then I'd sell them on an online store. And I learned a lot from that experience. I made very little money. And bearing in mind that scrapbook kits are huge in terms of file size, and I had 20 megabytes a month to work with. So that was almost, it was just never going to work. But I learned a lot from the process in terms of selling online and packaging your stuff digitally and creating previews specifically to get people's attention, because when you're selling something online, they can't touch and feel it. So the graphic preview that you give them is very important, especially if it's a digital product. So that was how I started. And then Dr. Manny came out with the book club in the Warrior Forum, and we started talking about KDP and writing books and getting that sort of stuff done. And I think you were part of that club, David.
Who's it? Who's that, sorry?
The book club and the Warrior Forum. Remember that Dr. Manny did?
No, I wasn't part of that.
Okay.
No.
Well, anyway, he then he took us through the whole process of KDP. And then all of a sudden, at some point, and I can't remember when it was, I think it might have been 2015, 2016, coloring books took off.
Yeah.
And then that led to journals and planners and that sort of thing. And the skills that I'd learned as a digital scrapbook designer were absolutely perfect for the low content industry. And so that's how I ended up getting into those kind of books.
And so, Di, have you done, tell us some of the different kinds of low content books that maybe you've done or that potentially people could do?
Okay, so initially I was just doing print books through KDP, and then obviously printables where people could download the title. So you're talking about the types of books or formats of books or?
Types of books, really. What, like manuals, diaries?
Yeah. Okay. So we've done so many. When I say we, it's also my daughter now who's with me. We've done actual diaries, you know, daily, weekly, monthly planners and diaries. We've done prayer journals, we've done recipe books, we've done a community journal, we've even done a cannabis journal, interestingly enough. Any topic that's of interest to somebody. So recently I've just released a fruit preservation planner, you know, given the fact that I'm into the gardening and the raising of the chickens and that. So we've released a prepper journal. The one I just released recently was about a financial crisis. So given what we've been going through in the COVID situation, you know, how are people coping economically? And it's not so much personal as it's what is happening to the global economy and how can you, you know, work your way through that. So we just, whatever people are interested in, I mean, you've got people who buy dog journals as an example. And let's take a simple dog journal where you've got a basic pet care manual, but you can gear the same journal to different breeds of dogs. And so you could have 400, 600 different books out there that are basically the same inside, but they're geared to the different dogs. And I think the secret here, if you'll excuse me, the secret that I've learned is that the tighter you niche down, Dave, the more money you make.
Uh-huh.
If you go too general, there's too many people out there being too general. But if you go down to the woman of 25 who own a boxer, that kind of niche down, you will find that you become a lot more successful in selling your books because now you're hitting the right button with that group of people.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, absolutely digging down to whereby whatever you're offering is absolutely on point. For someone who's got a credit card in their hand.
Yeah.
And so, Di, you mentioned that you also do printables. How are you selling those? I mean, so obviously you can print books through KDP and other print-on-demand services. I quite like using Lulu. Lulu.com does excellent quality compared to the Amazon quality. There is no comparison. Have you printed through Lulu at all?
I have done one and I wasn't happy at all. So.
All right. Oh, wow. I've had the exact opposite experience. Yeah, I found their quality to be very, very good.
So what's really interesting is, you know, with Amazon, you can't do spiral bound books. And for me, if you do the research, you will find on Amazon that the spiral notebooks, spiral bound notebooks, outsell the perfect bound notebooks. But as KDP people, we cannot sell spiral bound. Mm. So 3 years ago, we went looking for a solution about finding spiral bound printers, and I found one in the US, and I'm happy to share that information with you guys later. It's a company called snowfallpress.com. And so it works the same as Amazon. You just upload your book, but they don't sell the book for you. You just place the order and then you drop ship it to your customer. So
they drop ship it. The order's placed, they print it, they send it.
Exactly. Ah, okay. Now, initially, because I couldn't open up an Amazon seller's account, which is slightly different to an Amazon KDP account, I was selling them and still am selling them on Etsy. I sell a lot of my spiral bound versions of whatever books on Etsy.
Okay.
My most popular one being a diabetes journal through Etsy.
And how are you getting people, how are you getting traffic to that store?
So Etsy sends a lot of traffic itself.
Okay. So as long as you niche in and really get things okay, wow.
But they also have an advertising program, which I utilize. And they also link to Google ads. So I have got a very tight budget where I will only pay 5 cents a click. That's all I'm prepared to pay. But it works because the tighter I keep the budget, the more money I make. And my income this year is triple what it was last year. So it's definitely building up there.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, I've kind of touched Etsy a little, but to be honest, I kind of literally just dabbed my toe in it. It's something that really interests me. In fact, I've had conversation with Tiffany about Etsy. It was Etsy we spoke about, wasn't it, Tiff? Yeah, I'm interested in it because it's like a whole other world of financial opportunity for the kind of stuff that certainly I'm producing and many of us here may be already producing or could produce. Yeah. It seems that you can get a nicer markup sometimes on Etsy because there's a different shopper there.
Well, the thing is you actually determine the selling price. So with KDP, KDP will give us 35%, or it depends on the margin on the print book. But with Etsy, let's say you're selling a printable, a digital download, you sell it for whatever you want, and Etsy only takes 3.5%.
And so when you say a digital download, what, are you talking just pages or are you talking entire books or?
Well, some of my stuff is an entire PDF. So I call them binders. I wonder if I could give you an example. Let me quickly see if I can find it. Maybe I'll just share my screen with you. Give me 1 second and I'll find it. Okay, David, how do I share my screen? Let's see.
Do you see a button down at the bottom of this thing saying share screen or?
Yes, I do. Okay.
Yeah.
I know it says host disabled participant screen sharing.
Let me have a look.
You might have to make her a
code. Who can share? Here we go. Try again.
Okay. Can you all see that?
We can.
Okay. So this is my legacy for life. I've actually got 3 stores on Etsy, but I'll get into that just now. So this is my most public brand that I don't mind sharing. There are a couple of other pen names that I don't share. So this is my legacy for life plan. Is now what you'll see is I've done over here is, let me find you a really good example. This one here, here's my Bible study one. Let's move that. And that is a PDF download. So what people, they call them binders. So what people will do is they'll download that PDF and then they will punch it and put it into a file. And you can see it's $10. It's not cheap for a PDF. Yeah. So you definitely make more money. So let me give an example. This is a video that I've got that shows within it. I don't know if you can see it. Just give it a second.
Yeah.
Okay. And this is the secret to selling on Etsy as well, is to give as many graphic images that I was talking about so that the customers can actually see what it is that they're getting. Okay. So
actually make something that's really honestly intangible, tangible exactly. to the people who are buying.
And that's why I do these kind of preview images that looks like a file and looks like a spiral bound book or whatever. Now this is.
And how are you creating these images, Di?
So these images I create through Photoshop, and then this, let me just go back to this one here that I had. And then I use a site called My eCover Maker, which is the simplest way to do it.
Is that now, free or is that a paid service?
So you can do free, and then some of them you. So what I do is I've taken up the monthly subscription for $14.99, and because I do so many, I'll probably do 100 book covers a month. It's totally worth it. You can sign up for a free account, and then some of the covers you get for free, but the spiral bands and that sort of thing you pay $4.99 a cover. So if you're going to do more than three covers a month, it's absolutely worth your while to do the paid subscription. And that is one payment that I have absolutely no problem with, because it really is a good service. So it's myecovermaker.com.
Okay.
And it does all these sort of things. Let me show you another example. Here's one. This kind of spiral bound, that's just a mock-up.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so it does a whole lot of stuff for you.
And where are you getting your ideas from, Di, for these various kinds of books, various kinds of journals? Where do you get your ideas from? What's the research? How does your brain work to land on, hey, I'm going to do a diabetes logbook, or I'm going to do, you know, XYZ kind of journal? What's the process?
Okay, so one of the things that I did do 2 years ago is I ran a survey with my customers, with my PLR planners business, the business to business aspect. And I gave them, whoever answered the survey, I gave a $20 discount to my store, which meant that hundreds and hundreds of people filled it in. And as a result, I got so much valuable information about the kinds of planners and journals that people were looking for, that I have not run out of material yet. But the bottom line is, if you belong to several Facebook groups that talk about different aspects. So I'll give you an example. You don't actually have to look much further than inside your normal circle. Listen to what your friends are saying. Listen to what your family are talking about. So if somebody's got Lyme disease, an example, put together a Lyme disease journal or tracker that'll enable them to track their symptoms, what's triggering it, that kind of thing. And that's niching down very much, of course. And so something like that will sell very well, like the diabetes. So the diabetes tracker lets them track their blood sugar, what they've eaten, what did they have any triggers. We've done depression and anxiety journals as well. You know, whatever challenges people are dealing with, you find a solution for them and you do it in a journal or a planner.
And how long does it take you to create a journal on average? Obviously it's going to vary, but.
David, it takes me half a day. Okay. But that's because I've been doing it for so long, and I also use several automation tools. So to give you an example,
it looks like you do nice high quality. It's not just like a page with some lines on.
No, it's not. You know, so if I design a 2021 planner as an example, I've got automation tools that will take that basic layout that I've now designed and then run through and repeat it for the whole year. So if I had to try and do that manually, that would take a lot longer.
Mm-hmm. And you actually provide... You mentioned your B2B side of your business.
Yes.
It would be PLR, wouldn't it? Private label rights. Is that correct?
That's correct. It's this site here. Am I still sharing my screen?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
So tell us a little bit about that side of the business, because this is as well is real interesting, is that instead of just being the person kind of B2C offering the journals, Di actually moved into and does a very, very efficient job at actually serving other people who are producing the journals. So she sells resources that help others produce the journals that they then go on to sell. And so again, it's just another way that you can think outside the box sometimes and think, okay, how can I become a seller of the spades and the buckets here? As something that I've certainly done as well in the past.
Mm. Yeah, and I think the main reason why I started to do this is because a lot of people were asking me, Di, you know, please could we buy a basic layout from you and then republish it as our own? Because not everybody's designers and not everybody has the kind of free time that I do, because obviously I'm not doing this full time, but a lot of people are working full time. You know, then they come home and they still have to cook and take care of their families, and they're just not finding the time. So it kind of grew out of that. And so let me give an example of what a basic planner would do for somebody. I designed the whole thing with graphics and everything. Here we go down over here. Okay, here's a cat lover's journal as an example.
Oh, here we go, cat journals.
So a cat journal, a simple cat journal. And if you then see this, according to the website, there's 373 million pet cats in the world. Okay, there are people that are cat crazy. There are people that are going to look at this journal and say, I want it because I love cats. It's that simple. So you're playing to people's passions and what they're passionate about. So in this particular cat journal, we've got birth records, photographs, face, bed details, pet sisters, memories, all those kind of things. And somebody who's not a cat lover will not understand this. But if anybody's sitting in this Zoom call who's a cat lover will know exactly what I'm talking about.
Oh, the funny thing is, Di, when we first opened the Christian Creative Academy, I had a little kind of cat journal thing going on myself. But my cat journal doesn't even come close to this. So I might be the one jumping in to PLR planners and buying this. You know, this might become the innards of my 50 cat journals that I've got.
So this is, again, because we're selling an intangible on the internet, one of the things was I was trying to figure out how we could make it easy for people to see. So this is a flipbook software, which is really great to show people the interior of your book. And I'll have to send you the link for that one because it's a funny website name.
If Di, after the event, you can send me a list of these various links to your sites and your resources and some of the things that you've mentioned, I can send it out to people with the replay. If that's okay.
No, that's absolutely fine.
It'd be great for people to have access to this, you know, this kind of resource at PLR planners themselves, you mean, so they can pick up some bits if they want to kind of move forward in some of their projects.
Yeah, but also, yes, and I'm delighted about that, but I think also you know, these are the kind of tools you need if you're going to be selling online. And this is what I try and teach my coaching clients. You know, what do we use to sell online? And so this was a good example of creating a flipbook. It gives the user the feel of actually reading a book, you know, and they can see what's inside. So that's just another idea.
Yeah, yeah.
Hmm. Okay, so then what we do is, in terms of a resource, we give them this whole planner. They can then go and edit it, change it around, tweak it, put new graphics in, whatever, and then they can publish it as their own. So that is the purpose of PLR planners.
And I see here, Di, that you sell PowerPoint documents. Is PowerPoint I'm asking this question rhetorically, really, because this is what I use PowerPoint myself. But for others here, is PowerPoint, have you found that to be the best software for kind of developing and creating low content journals?
Well, it's the most easily accessible, and that was the big reason for me focusing on PowerPoint, because you can do them in Photoshop, but not everybody's got Photoshop skills. You can do it in InDesign. A lot of these big planner people use InDesign, I don't use InDesign. It's too expensive and too complicated for me to even use. So what we were looking for is, what is a tool that's relatively readily available and is easy to use? And what have most people used in their life? They've used PowerPoint. So along with Sue Fleckenstein, because Sue was the one who got me started on the PowerPoint side, that's how we started designing them, because it's a graphic program where you can drag and drop and set up images where you want them.
And so someone's asking, could we use something like Microsoft Publisher, which I'm sure you could. I think the key thing, though, is that you got to be able to kind of spit the thing out ultimately as a PDF. That's correct, wouldn't it?
So
when you upload to the various sites, it would be a PDF that you would upload. You wouldn't be able to upload kind of just a native Microsoft Publisher file or a PowerPoint file. You've actually got to be able to export as PDF, which I know certainly the Microsoft suite can.
Another tool that a lot of people have now started using is Affinity. Which is a very...
All right, yeah, Affinity Publisher, yes.
Affinity Publisher, and my daughter actually jumped on the bandwagon and brought out a training course on that, which was phenomenal. And I'm not just saying that because she's my daughter, but she, you know, she picked up that everybody was talking about this Affinity. She looked at it and she said, you know, Mom, I think we could do a training course on this. So it's a super product to use, and particularly when you get into what we call digital planners, which is a whole different ball game.
Yeah. Now, Di, I'd like to just open up the floor for, unless you got something. I know you were talking when we were chatting previously, you were saying about kind of mindset things and stuff like that, that can be around entrepreneurism and, you know, this whole kind of adventure and sometimes battle that we're in, you know. But I'd also love to open up the floor for questions for people as well. But Di, if you've got something particular that you'd like to share with people before that, please feel free if there's something on your heart.
That's fine. Maybe we'll just wait for some questions, see what people have to ask.
And anyone here have any questions while we've got Di with us? Please don't be shy. Oh, here we go.
Hi, Di. I'm in Di's group, and I met Di through David, actually. Or no, I met David through Di.
Here we go. Thank you, Di.
Another
reason for me to be a big appreciator of you, Di. There you go. See.
Yeah. And the reason I found Di was because I was looking for a gardening journal, and I found a gardening journal for myself, and I found one to use, and I actually sell the PLR gardening journal on Etsy and have made quite a few sales from the digital gardening journal. But anyway, my question is, you said you had more than one Etsy shop. What's the reason for that?
Okay, so the reason for different shops or different businesses is that depending on who's your target market. So my Etsy shop that I showed you is business to consumer. My other Etsy shop is like my PLR planners, which is business to business. So in that, I don't know if you can see my mic. So my other store is commercial use items, pretty much what PLR planners does, where I sell resources that other people can use. So that Etsy store is just another avenue to market in terms of getting potential customers to my business.
And do you have to pay to have an Etsy store, or is an Etsy store free and they make their money from taking a slice?
You've got two options. It used to be a case where you would just pay the transaction fee and 20 cents per listing every time you listed something new. They do have a monthly paid option. I think it's $39. It's a bit like the Amazon seller's account, but you can pick and choose which you want. And with the more advanced one, you get more benefits, that kind of thing. I haven't really switched because, you know, my primary focus has been my own website. And I think that's really important, is that you spend as much of your energy driving people to your own website and not to third-party websites. So Amazon and Etsy are great, but they can pull the rug out from you at any second. And so I'm very cognizant of that fact. So that's what I'm building up. I'm focusing the attention on my actual own virtual real estate. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. And so you actually just sell direct. So people would purchase direct from your site and they would download then like a zip file or a PDF or whatever directly from you.
Yes, correct. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Sorry, my dog's come to sell it. Off you go.
Do you need, Di, do you need special permission to get more than one store on Etsy, or it's in their terms of service?
It's a separate email for each Etsy store.
Okay.
Yeah. Anything else?
Any other questions, folks, while we've got the opportunity here? Questions about entrepreneurship, building an online business, questions about developing out low content books, selling PLR, private label right stuff, so where you could create resources yourself and then sell for other people to utilize.
So Diane, I've got a question. Basically, for those that are starting out in this whole journey, how did you first start off? I mean, like, I'm hearing all these things that you do, but obviously that was built up over time. So how would you start off to do, say, a journal, your first ever one? What process or what tools do you need to have?
Okay, so my belief is that you start off really small with the baby steps. And if you've never created a journal before, create a lined journal with a pretty cover and put it up onto Etsy or Amazon. It's as simple as that. Once you've done a line journal, it gives you that confidence to say, okay, you know what? I've done it. I've got the process right. Now let me create a journal, a recipe journal. I mean, how difficult is it to put together a recipe page? Slap a pretty picture on the cover and put up the recipe journal. And as you go on, you'll find yourself getting more and more confident and say, okay, that looks nice. You go and look at Pinterest. Pinterest is a great place to go and source ideas, not to steal the ideas, but just to get inspired, because you'll look at something and you say, gosh, you know, I really like that, but what if I switch that around? And then once you start doing that, you'll be able to start designing more and more complex planners and journals. As
in the new year, I'm going to put together another challenge, like, and it'll be a journal challenge. So It is similar to what we did with the short books that we did. So we'll do a journal challenge in the new year that we'll go through utilizing PowerPoint and probably some of the resources that Di introduces us to here. We might try and incorporate some of those as well. So any other questions tonight? Anything that you'd like to ask Di and Wash is here?
Bill. I have a question for Di. Appreciate you coming on with us, Di. Thank you very much. My wife Julie is here with us. We have been doing at times some low content publishing, and I guess I have a twofold question for you, Di. We have noticed over the last year that of I don't know how many, like 10 million print on demand books on Amazon. If you've used that KDP, their print on demand, it just seems like the market is flooded with low content. And we know of people that are putting out 50 to 100 books or more a week. How do we compete in that sort of market? Or the second part question, Di, is do you recommend that a person really gets away from that market or Amazon and set up their own like their own ebook store on their own website and have greater control over it? How do you deal with that?
Okay, so the reason why people would go to Amazon in the first place is because they've got the traffic. The challenge is that there's a million of us little guys out there on Amazon, and unless you have to spend a lot of time building your brand up outside of Amazon, which takes time. And again, the same principle applies with my Legacy for Life planners. I still have my own website. Now, that is a new exercise, which I've only started in the last year, taking it, trying to drive people from Facebook, from YouTube, from not so much Twitter, because I don't use Twitter, and from Etsy to my live website itself. So my recommendation to you is you need to do both. Publish your books on Amazon, publish them on your own website, but make, here's the key in Amazon. And if you don't mind, Dave, I want to quickly share something with you if I can just find it. Let me just share my screen and I'll show you. This has been one of the biggest drivers to my business. Can you see this here? This Journal Empire.
Mm-hmm.
So what that is it's a book that I wrote in print version and ebook version. And it said Journal Empire, How to Make Money with Journals and Planners. It's probably a 100-page book. It's not that massive, but the secret is that inside this book, first of all, I've got my name and I've got my domain name in the look inside. And more than that, I have got somewhere, I think I may have taken it out. There is a link to a free workbook on my website. So if they go into my website, sorry, just give me a second to find it again. I've lost it. If they go into my website and they bought the book, there's a discount code inside the book, which they can then go in and download the workbook for free. And it's a companion workbook. Now, David, you mentioned this when you first started talking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, this book has resulted in, and I did a video on this on YouTube, in $38,000 worth of turnover just from this book to my PLR Planners website.
Wow.
So to answer your question, Bill, you need to do both. You need the exposure from Amazon. You need to spend time in Facebook and social media building up your brand. And you need to do all of that with the primary aim of sending them all back to your own website. So just think of it as a wheel with a hub, and in the center is your own website, and everything outside is all driving in towards the website.
Great. That's Thank you, Di. Yes.
And if I can add, Bill, this is one of the keys that I've found, certainly with the prayer journals, is sometimes, you know, we talk about people producing 100 journals a month and things like that. One high quality journal that stands out from the crowd can outstrip 10,000 crappy journals that people are pumping out without any thought or care for the people that they're actually trying to sell them to. I've done both. I've done like lined journals and just pumped them out. In fact, I've got about 4,000 journals that I'll put out next year that are going to be the same inside with a different cover on the front. But at the same, just throwing at the wall to see if it sticks, because you just never know. But really where I look to make real money is to, like with anything else that I produce, is to provide extreme value in what I deliver to market. And that's where some of my best-selling prayer journals really have hit the mark for me, because I put a lot of thought and a lot of time into the production. The great thing is though, the time that I put in to produce the innards of those journals have now become three or four different journals that are aimed at specific little slivers of the market, pretty much the same inside. So I've put the work in up front. But yeah, if you can create a standout product, that can make a real difference. And obviously the challenge is you are putting all that work in up front without the guarantee that it will be standout. You know, in the sense of, you know, you can't just say, all right, if I produce this, you know, what do they say? You know, build it and they will come. It just doesn't work like that, you know. But certainly creating something that sets you apart from the kind of, oh yeah, we put out 100 journals every week crowd can make a big difference. And so sometimes that really means knowing the market that you're selling to. So you can give them exact, you know, man, this is what they are looking for, and I'm going to give it to them in spades. Sorry, Di, for just stage there for a moment, but that's certainly something that I found made a big difference from kind of a mediocre income and response to something that I would say was, well, certainly for me, more remarkable.
Dave, if I may, you know, when we were talking earlier, looking at the market, I mean, so many people are focused on this whole KDP printables, planners and journals. And what's really worked for me over the last year is looking at ways that we can take the same work we've done and repurpose it a multitude of ways. So some of you may be aware of the fact that at the beginning of this year, I came up with the concept of digital planners, which means they're physical files that get uploaded to apps like an iPad in GoodNotes, and they flip like diaries, you know, and you tap them and they hyperlinked and they jump all over the place. And that has been an exceptionally powerful market for me this year. Same with OneNote, taking what you've created and making it applicable to OneNote. And we've got trainings, Dave, and I'll send you all the links and that with that.
Yeah, please do.
So
yeah.
If you take one planner that you've created, you can sell it as a print book on Amazon. You can sell it as a spiral bound. You can sell it as a PDF. You can sell it as a GoodNotes digital planner. You can sell it as a OneNote planner. And you can also, which is my latest thing that I've come up with, is go and set it up as Google Slides that teachers can use in the Google Classroom, as an example. So you've got to constantly look at way that people can use information. And with one bit of work and a bit of tweaking, you've got seven new markets. Okay. And that's the kind of thing you constantly have to think about. You cannot sit back and say, oh, everybody's publishing to KDP. Yes, they are. And the minute we came out with the training for the digital planner, everybody was selling digital planners on Etsy, but it doesn't matter because you're going to build up a repertoire for a solid product that you're creating, and you've expanded your marketplace. So you're not just reliant on Amazon or Etsy or, you know, that kind of thing. So I think that's really important. So always be open to other ways of selling what you've created.
Nikki says here, Di, that you are a true entrepreneur. What could you speak to, Di, just in that vein, like just entrepreneurial mindset? We've got, I'm not sure what time it is. What have we got? We've got like 5 minutes or so. And we'll stick around for a few questions if other people have got questions. But Di, just speak to that just briefly about an entrepreneurial mindset. Because clearly you have one. Just speak into that for people.
So I don't know if I was born like this. Or if I grew into it. I do remember reading a book at 16 called The Woman of Substance, and it inflamed me because she was this woman who was single, went through a whole lot of challenges and built up this massive business. I don't like working for people. So I have that problem where I just don't like to, you know, working in a corporate environment. So that combined, I don't know. So the question is, are we born entrepreneurs? Are we made entrepreneurs? I think bottom line is, if you got this hankering to own your own business, you're basically an entrepreneur. But it's not just a case of, okay, well, I'm going to open up a business and I'm going to make money. You constantly have to look at what it is that you're doing in your business. Are you wasting your time? If you're wasting your time, you need to drop it and move on to something that's more productive. And I think the big thing is the question I keep asking myself every time I think about a particular product line or service, will it add value to my customer? Not how much money is it going to make me, will it add value? Because if the answer is yes, it's going to add value, you automatically make money. I don't know if that makes any sense. But it's very challenging because you constantly have to be looking for new ideas. And as Dave and I were talking earlier on, that can sometimes result in a burnout, which happened to me this year. So you need to take some time out where you're constantly looking for ideas and inspiration and doing a lot of research. And I watch a lot of YouTube and watch a lot of alternative YouTube because it always sparks an idea. But at the same time, you've also got to stop and say, you know what, I'm going to go and do some gardening now or go and have a sleep, because I'm the kind of person who tends to push it too hard until I burn out. And this was a case in about a month and a half ago. So being an entrepreneur is very exciting, but it's not easy.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not, certainly not for the faint hearted.
No.
That's for sure. We've got Nina asking here if when we share the links, you might be able to share some of the links to some of the automation tools that you speak of and things like that.
If you go into my website, you'll see it's all, it's got various categories, but there's automation.
Which website are we talking here?
The plrplanners.com.
plrplanners.com.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I've got different types of resources, automation tools, print planners, digital planners, templates, coloring in books, papers and covers, stickers, illustrations, budget bars, training courses, freebies. Oh, and we have a community initiative, and this was something that we started when COVID was announced. A lot of people are obviously battling financially out there. So what I decided to do was run a community initiative where I would allow somebody to upload a product onto our website and we'd sell it for them. And that made a few people a bit of money, which was really great. So being an entrepreneur is not just about trying to make money for yourself, but it's about helping other people. And I think that's important for me.
Yeah, come on, Di. Thank you so much. Any other questions here tonight from anyone?
I had another one. So I'm confused about when you're uploading to KDP and you're producing, like, say you're producing 20 of the same journal, but you're just changing maybe the background or the color. When you're entering the title and the subtitle and the description, what are you supposed to change? So with those 20 journals, are you changing the title or all the keywords stay the same? How does that work? How does your process work with that?
Yeah, so in the beginning when I was doing that, because I've stopped doing that now, David and I both done it where you throw mud at the wall with the different covers, I would simply have journal notebook, 128 pages, 6x9, pink cover or pink flowers or sunshine. You know, I would just change one word at the end to describe the cover. I don't do that anymore because now I'm very specific about what David was talking about is rather loading one high quality product and pushing the marketing on that side of thing. But yes, you can do that. You have the same
time. You could have like one journal in like the innards of a journal, the same or very similar. Yeah. And then you could have like pug dog journal, you know, I don't know, dogs, like Labrador
Rotty
journal or whatever. Yeah. Yeah. And yet the insides could be very, very similar.
Just the cover. You're required to change like one word.
The cover and maybe the title page on the inside of the journal or something of that similar nature.
So to give you,
I did very well with prayer journals. Initially, that's how I got into the prayer journal market. Is I had one inside, which was virtual, really lined pages with then a quote. I mean, the quotes were fire. You know, like wow, they were like, I collected about 200 quotes from great men and women of God over the years, had that in the footer and then just lines on the page. And then I did various covers, you know, prayer journals for women, prayer journals for men, prayer journals, blah, 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 you name it. I mean, all sorts of different ones, but And so that worked quite well. But yeah, so it was really just a change of title and maybe the title page on the inside, and that was it.
I mean, you could do something similar where you could have Kerry's journal, Nina's journal, Charles's journal. You know, you could do name journals and things like that. Or you could do monogram journals. And I mean, those have done quite well as well for me in the past. Okay, so you're going to pick the 200 top names for male and females in the US, and you're going to create 200 journals.
Someone's asking here, Di, do your Etsy products have their own barcode?
No.
Do you have to buy barcodes?
No. You're talking about an ISBN for, like with KDP? Need an ISBN for Etsy. The only time you would ever really need an ISBN is if you were going to take your spiral bound book and sell it in the retail bookshops. But since I'm not selling it in the retail bookshops, the only case when I did need an ISBN, and that was something I hadn't really touched on, was when I opened up my Amazon sellers account. So now I can sell my spiral bounds through Amazon. For that, I had to get an ISBN.
Thank you, Di. Any other questions, folks, before we allow Di to go to bed?
Yeah, I have one. You might have already answered this, but I'm not really amazingly technical. So all you guys that are, I'm more of an artist and dancer, but I do want to write books as well. And I'm really interested in the whole journal thing. But where would I start? I do Word, and that's about where I'm at. I don't know about KDPs and all these different things. It's just a bit, sometimes when you talk about all these things, I don't really understand what half of them are. So
well, we'll be doing it.
Yeah,
in the new year, Louise, I'll do a a journal challenge. I mean, I'll just be working through KDP because I don't know Etsy and things like that, but it will certainly introduce you to some of the basics of journal creation, which may be helpful. Yeah, so, okay. But Di, sorry, I'm you.
No. And I was going to say, I mean, that's a good idea. I do have a couple of free courses on my website, which I'll get Dave to send you the links. There's one that gets you started on PowerPoint and it's free, and then it takes you through loading the book onto KDP. So that might be a start. Obviously, my spiral book training is also free on the website, Dave, and I'll get you those links.
Wow, great. And paid training, what do you do? What would be your number one recommendation for your paid training if someone wanted to go into this with kind of boots and all, Di?
When you say paid training,
well, I mean, but what courses do you offer? You're talking about free training here, which is great. But you got paid courses and things as well and memberships? Yeah, paid, sorry, yeah.
Yes, I do. But I think, you know, we lead into that. My thing with people is if you're just starting out, start with the free training courses because that gets your feet wet and that gets you going. I've got a couple of other training courses. But let me just see. I'll tell you now if there's anything. Yeah, now you see, most of them are more complex into the digital planner side of things. But
okay,
the free training will get them going, David, in terms of the getting started for KDP. I mean, you really don't need much more than that.
That's great. Thank you, Di.
No, it's only a pleasure. And but honestly, if you've got any questions, please feel free to give me a shout again. I'm happy to come and have a natter with you guys again. It's not that late. So
any final questions?
Thank you, Diana, for this. It's been brilliant. And I was actually working on a planner today and I really wanted to be spiral bound. And I thought I was going to have to be, if I wanted print on demand, be stuck with the KDP. So the Snowfall Press that you recommended, I would definitely be checking them out. And also, I wanted to know if you maybe know of anyone who does print-on-demand magazine printing?
So magazine, I'm not too sure about. I do know Printful and Gutenberg are starting to move into that area. I've been doing some research on that. But I can't tell you offhand who does magazines. I'd have to research that and get back to you on that, Camilla.
You know, you could actually do that through KDP.
Magazine.
Yeah. Oh, mind you, you're talking full color, aren't you?
Full color.
Yeah. No. Yeah, yeah, it would be pretty pricey. By the time once you start adding color to the mix, it starts racking the price up, doesn't it? With POD.
Yeah.
Diane, you are such a blessing to so many people. You really are, and you have been such an extreme blessing to us here tonight. Thank you so much. Thank you for sending Tiffany our way.
We love
Tiffany,
she is such a blessing. I would just like to tell, in her Facebook group, she gives away things. She's so helpful. Yeah, she is a blessing, David. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just a true Christian entrepreneur. Yeah. You can just tell by her spirit of giving. She's just like she said, she lives by her motto, will it add value to my customer? So I'm grateful.
Would you be comfortable, Di, for me to pray for you before we close?
I'm fine with that. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, Father, we just thank you so much for Diane. We thank you, God, for your the wonderful heart, the generosity that she's shown here tonight. Lord Jesus, you declare in your word that if we give, it will be given unto us good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. And that is what we declare over Di's household, Father. We just thank you, Father, for the gifts and the anointing on her life. And we pray, Father, and declare prosperity over everything that she puts her hand to in the name of Jesus. Bless her, bless her, bless her, bless her. Refresh her spirit. Refresh and strengthen her spirit in the name of Jesus. Let her know your grace. Let her know your peace. Let her know your goodness and just restore her soul in such a wonderful way, Father. Lead her by still waters, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Di, you are such a great blessing. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We so appreciate you. Cool. And thanks all for coming tonight. I'll be sending out the replay together with a bunch of awesome links that you will probably need about 3 months to go through and check out. I'm sure this won't be the last time that we have Di with us. I'm sure there'll be a great demand for more Diana. Amen. Yeah. Hey, God bless you, Di. Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Bye.
Good night,
thank
all.
You, thank you, David.
Bye.
God
thank
bless
you
all. Good night. Good night.